Welcome to Critical Thought TV. This is Stuart Mason Dambrot. I'm your host. We're speaking with Dr. Randal Koene about substrate independent minds. And right now, Dr. Koene, one thing I'd really like to ask you about is something that I read in your papers that is completely fascinating to me. I couldn't get enough of it, and that is universal Darwinism that occurs in an information universe in which the nature of universal Darwinism is pattern survival rather than gene survival.
Right.
Take it away.
Okay, well, this is something that, of course, I had to think about at some point. I mean, what are the motivations? What drives me to want to do something like substrate-independent minds? Why could it be important, or why would you even want something like this? And one of the things that that I was thinking about is what happens if you think in really big terms, big picture, long term, look at the universe from, say, a perspective many billions of years ahead or so. What do you assume has happened to it? So what's going on in this universe? Everything is constantly competing. Competing just means that there's selection between things. You can have a selection between living things, but you can also have the same selection going on between anything, really, like big asteroid versus small, dense asteroid, and they collide, and what happens afterwards.
So you could even universal call Darwinism, superposition and collapse a form of competition in some abstract way.
There is yes, because competition is really just a term where we describe a selection going on, and we say something is the winner and something's the loser. So you know that there's always this thing going on. And if you look at that and you take into account how there are very many different environments, different challenges, things that happen, all the processes that are going on and all of this selection going on, what does that mean in terms of intelligent life? What sort of intelligent life could come to mean the most in the sense that it has the biggest influence on what's going on in the biggest parts of the universe in space and in time? So what occupies the most space-time? And then, well, the conclusion that I came to is, well, it has to be something that can adapt to so many challenges and environments, something that's really flexible and adaptable, so substrate independent, for example. And that's where that differs from genes, which are developed to work and be selected for within the environment of the Earth in the current time, and really just within a very small window of our history. That's where we appear and our genes are selected for.
So that's that would indicate that perhaps that long-term, the genetic mode of expression. I remember, to paraphrase Kurt Vonnegut, he said, life is just the gene's way of, you know, staying alive.
That's absolutely correct. Yeah. It's really about the genes and not about us. That's where it started. The only reason we're here is because it happened to be a useful way for genes to replicate themselves.
So what happens then in this far future, which is occupied by life in the form of patterns, of patterns that are selected for through this universal Darwinism, where there's almost the potential for a blurring of the lines between the organic and the inorganic, because everything's competing for an intelligent occupation of space-time. So what happens then to genetic replication in a pattern replication environment?
Well, it's not so much that something happens. It's more that genetic replication is just one small subset of possible ways in which patterns can replicate. And these, they optimize towards the replication of these patterns of DNA, so sequences of bases that may be very meaningful in terms of the survival of certain sets of DNA, but it's not very meaningful to the things that we personally care about right now. So what has happened? Minds have evolved from all of this genetic replication. And in those minds, we have completely different interests, things that have nothing to do with what is the DNA that we have versus the DNA of a bird or a lizard or an ant. Is it really interesting what those bases are? Only in terms of how it influences what we can do with our minds, our capabilities, etc. So that's what we really care about now, more than we do, say, you know, which genes happen to have spread the most on the planet.
So if I take you correctly, then, since everything we're doing, science and technology, is in some ways at a very abstract level an expression, an instantiation of an idea, and that idea emerges from our brains. So it's, in Jason Silva's words, we extrude reification. Paraphrasing as well. He used the extrude, I threw in the reification. But that would suggest that as a subset of pattern, of pattern survival, would something would a gene then be considered a subset, if you will, of something like a meme, whatever that is like in this distant future? Is a meme as an ideational component analogous to a pattern that's more abstract?
When I think of contrasting memes as a type of pattern, or not necessarily memes, but the thinkers of memes who then propagate memes, versus genes, it's that the one takes place in that area where we seem to have a great interest in what goes on, the sort of thing that we write about in history, like the kinds of new society that we create or the sort of inventions that we come up with. The genes are really just about constructing a body, and then that body becomes a good environment for those genes to survive in and replicate and carry on.
I see. That's even better. Because what we're saying is it's not the thoughts or the memes that are the patterns, it's the thinkers. It's actually those that are, it's us. It's us and within a substrate independent sense. This is making, it's becoming more clear to me, I think, now, that the dispersal, if you will, of intelligence throughout a far future universe relies on having, of necessity, substrate-independent, cohesive patterns.
If you wanted to have a great influence on the universe, this is the whole thing. I mean, there are many different ways that you could shape the future. There are many, many routes we could take. These are part of the discussions we have every day, is what should we do? Which way should we go? What should we accomplish or not accomplish? And so to make one of those ways come out, let's say you have an idea of what you'd like to see happen in 5 years. This could be very different from maybe what I think should happen in 5 years or be the state of the universe in 5 years. And to make that happen, you try to propagate your memes, you try to tell other people why it's important, but you also put yourself behind it. So the best proponent of one way of moving forward, one type of thought, one meme, is yourself, because you're the one who's propagating that meme. And if you have more people who think that as well, that's the same thing. So allowing your patterns, that which makes you think and makes you develop those ideas further and bring them further and explain them to other people, is probably the strongest way to make those things happen.
And so, at this point, it happens through a biological interface. We have forms that are genetic expressions. If I'm understanding it, then this longer-term possible future, there would be less of a reliance, which is the whole idea I see now of substrate independence, on a particular form to create and propagate those patterns, even if they're a superset of what we refer to today as memes.
Right. It may sound a bit strange, but in effect, the way that we're propagating our memes right now is a bit indirect, because we have this dependence on the genes producing the body, which has the brain, which does the thinking and then speaks and explains things to other people. Right. So that you can then take the meme and have someone else with a different body pick that up and learn it as well, whereas you can just have the thoughts, the brain that is producing these thoughts, be able to exist in a variety of different forms, not worrying about how they come about, whether that's developed through biological development of a body from genes, or whether it's a mechanical body or a virtual body or whatever you want to do, as long as those thoughts can continue and can spread in a way.
So I see. So it's moving towards a direct connection between the originator of a thought and that thought and the recipient, if you will.
Right. It's a more direct, more efficient way, a way in which what we seem to care about the most, which, I mean, that's kind of where I'm coming from here, is saying that it looks like we care a lot now about our experiences, about the experience we have now, the experiences we have in 5 years or in 100 years, which is basically about ideas. Where do we want things to go? More than we do about, okay, the sequence ATGGGCCCDDAA, whatever, happens to be the one that got replicated more times than some other one. That's just not something I care about very much.
And also there's the whole differentiation that you mentioned in one of your papers between seeking rewards from the material consequences of pushing an idea forward, and just the joy of ideating. You didn't use those terms, but I'm using it. The actual pleasurable experience in creating an idea and seeing that flourish.
Yeah, actually the distinction I was trying to make is between persons who are, yes, perhaps satisfying their momentary experience in terms of having a pleasurable experience, being acquiring wealth and being able to do what they want to do so that they have a pleasurable experience. But what they're really doing is they're maximizing the potential for their genes to move forward because they're rich, and so they can protect their children better, they can provide for them, and their genes spread, versus mm-hmm. perhaps focusing directly on what you would like to see in the future, and therefore how you would like things to develop, and working on that directly rather than through this indirect route of just making sure that the genes continue, and then hope that somehow this also interfaces with where you would like things to go in the next few years. This isn't really the only point about that, though. I mean, it's really going back to that universal Darwinism and just thinking, what do you think is going to be there? If you think over spans of huge amounts of time and space, what is going to matter? And you just have to realize that where we are today, it looks like, okay, we're fine. We've developed to live well in this world. But really, this environment, this status quo, that's not guaranteed to continue. The Earth is not always going to have the environment we have now. The challenges aren't always going to be the same. We're not optimal for all the possible challenges. So this is not, you know, the status quo isn't just going to continue like that.
Very good. Thank you so much.